and welcome back to the Mark Wills bonus edition of Sam's Disney Diary. As you know, country music's Mark Wills is a huge Disney fan and was part of the Eat to the Beat concert performance on Epcot's 35th anniversary. For details, check out Sam's Disney Diary number 103. This video is the complete unedited media interview from the Epcot 35 media events. I hope you enjoy Congaloosh.
Started my career in 1996. I signed with Mercury Records in 95. We released our first album in, I think, May of 96. First single was a song called Jacob's Ladder, and we were very fortunate throughout my career to have a lot of top five records, a lot of number ones, several gold and platinum records. And then over the last, probably about the last 10 years, we've sort of been doing our stuff independently. There's been a big push in the music industry to kind of take on your own, you know, to sort of format what you do and continue on. And there's been sort of a shift in country music where it's transitioned from more of a traditional role to more of a pop type role. So we're continuing to do more of the traditional side of country music, which is what I believe country music is. That's kind of what it is for me.
Who are some of your musical inspirations?
My inspirations? Oh man, we could talk all day with that. I'm a huge fan of the music I grew up listening to. So like Alabama, Ronnie Millsap, Keith Whitley, Merle Haggard, George Jones. Not so much, you know, I didn't pattern my career after those entertainers. I just love great music. I love great melodic music. So if you go to, you know, YouTube or you pull up any of my songs, I'm a storyteller. That's what I feel like the music that really inspired me to become a country singer, that's what it was, a storytelling country. And that's what we've done from the very beginning, from the very first single we had, Jacob's Ladder, all the way through the new stuff that we're doing now. It kind of takes you on that 3.5 minute journey. You know, kind of close your eyes and formulate your own music video in your head, because that's the type of music that I grew up listening to and what I wanted to do when I became a musician.
What's some of the stuff you're working on now?
We've been in the studio. I'm sorry. Thank you, Charles, for prompting me. Hey guys, you should have a big screen in the back saying, talk about this thing. we're working on a new record. We've been in the studio. Took a little different direction-wise with the new music that we're doing. The road band, the guys that play music on the road every night, they're great musicians. And a lot of times in country music, if you know anything about like the LA sound from the late 50s to mid 70s, early 80s, they had a group called the Wrecking Crew, and that was the band that went in and played everything. They played all the music. They were the studio musicians, and that's sort of what Nashville become over the last 25 or 30 years. They had the same guys playing everything. So a lot of the music just started to sound the same. So for the new record, for the new stuff that we're doing now, we sort of took a little different direction and had the guys in the road band play the songs. Kind of feel like they're the best representation of what we do live. So that's what we're doing with the new stuff. We've tracked 3 or 4 different things. We're getting ready to go and start shopping our stuff for a new deal. And we've got a couple of companies we've been talking to for a while. They were just looking for us to kind of give them an idea as to what we wanted to do. So that's why we've started working on some new stuff.
Mark, you've proclaimed yourself the Disney junkie of country music.
I am.
There it is, proclamation again. Can you clarify just a little bit? When did that start and how did this? You gave us a little detail, but when did it start for you?
For me, the love of Disney started in different levels. Like, I think when my wife and I came down for our honeymoon in 96, you know, the castle was decorated as a big cake.
We try to forget about that, but that's okay.
There you go. And those are the pictures that I have. So we came down, and I remember being a kid. And in my family, we didn't have, you know, my mom and dad, who were actually here with me. I brought my mom and dad to Disney for my first time to play Disney, because for me, it's a special thing.
Sure.
You know, My mom and dad were able to come to Disney one time in their life. My dad was a truck driver. We didn't have a lot of expendable cash to leave Atlanta, you know, to leave Blue Ridge, Georgia, and come all the way to Orlando. So I came one time as a kid and spent one day at the Magic Kingdom, and you know, just loved it, just fell in love with it. As I got older, my wife and I, you know, when we were getting married, we decided, we started talking about where we wanted to spend our honeymoon. And she was like, well, let's just go to Disney. We can drive down, we can stay on property, we can spend 3 or 4 days in the park. And I had allotted 7 days for, you know, to like block off time because I was promoting an album. We were promoting singles. We were doing that kind of stuff. So it was an easy way, and we had to do it. We got married November 30th. It was the Saturday after Thanksgiving. So I thought, it's going to be easy. We'll just zip on down to Florida. 7 hours, took us like 15 to get here because of holiday traffic and all that, you know. But we came down and just fell in love with it then. And then would figure out ways, if I was playing the Orlando area or something, I would throw her on the bus with us, and we would come down the night before, and we would spend all day at the park. And every Orlando show that I had for the first 5 years, I was exhausted by the time I went on stage, because I opened the park that day. And then I went for the very last moment until I had to get, you know, ready and go on stage. And I would be on stage like, I do. You know, I remember one time I played a rodeo in Kissimmee, and I had opened Hollywood Studios at 7 a.m. that day. And we went to the studios, and we left the studios, and we came to the Magic Kingdom because my oldest daughter was like 3, and she wanted 3 or 4, and we wanted to do something there. And so literally we left there, and we dropped them off at the hotel, and they were supposed to come to the show. And I never saw them. I was like, where are y'all? And I got back to the bus, and they were asleep. They had totally just thrown me to the wolves and went to sleep, and I had to go on stage, and it was like a 90-minute show. We were playing for this rodeo. I've never been as exhausted as I was in my life. It's a totally different type of tired. I tell people, Disney tired is unlike any kind of tired you will ever experience in your life, and obviously y'all know this because you're here a lot.
That's right.
But yeah, so that was the beginning, and then I think as my kids got older, like last night I wore a Powerline shirt on stage. It was the, you know, I think the movies, all the different movies and all the different things that have come into being just have continued to grow our love and our admiration for the brand. And then working with them as well, because you not only are down here spending your money doing this kind of stuff, but you're receiving a lot in turn. I mean, we, you know, to get to come in and play Food and Wine, to get to play special events for, you know, families that come down and they want a concert. I mean, we've done some stuff like that. We played a show for a family that owned an NFL team. They wanted a concert, and they booked us to come down and play that. It was awesome. You know?
I mean, sure.
Who gets to go to Disney and play a show for, you know, for 12 people staring at you like this? It's weird, you know, but it's so cool. And you know, and through the cruises and all the different things that we've done and so many of our memories, and you'll understand this. I mean, how old are you?
14.
You're 14. Okay, so I have a daughter that's your age. I'm sure, is this your dad? You know, so you've been coming to Disney your whole life, right? Pretty much? Okay. So when you look back, when you're my age, when you're 44 years old, you're going to go back and you're going to look at pictures. And your pictures, your milestones in your mind are going to be when you were 8 and you got to meet Buzz Lightyear. And when you were 12 and you got, and so that's what's created all those memories. And, you know, and when we go back, I mean, every year we have a 2010 photo album of our pictures standing in front of the castle. We have a 2006, you know, we have all of those because that's what we did. We took our own pictures. And I think, and for me, when I look back at my childhood, those are some of my favorite things, to look back at my pictures. And for my kids, I think it's going to be the same way. I think that's my 20-minute answer to you, is that's what has brought me into just absolutely loving Disney, is just making all those memories.
So you played Food and Wine last night. You've played Disney Cruise Lines. Mm-hmm. Can you compare and contrast? What do you like best? What do you think?
They're different.
Sure.
You know, I mean, like the cruise line is one of the coolest things because we get. What's funny is that they don't ever tell people that we're getting on the ship.
Oh.
So we'll get on the ship, and we'll be on there 3 or 4 days. And like last year, we left out of Galveston, Texas, and this lady was on the ship with us. And every time I would walk in, I would see her on the ship, and she would look at me. She would be like. And we walk, you know, you walk into the lifeboat drill, and we're sitting like 2 tables away from her, and she's sitting there, she's going. And so, you know, we're just normal people. I just have a cool job, you know?
Yeah.
Normal guy, I just have a cool job. And so like the 3rd or 4th day, they run this video in the deal where, you know, where you go in and you go to the show, and they talk about what's coming up on the ship. And the cruise director goes, and this week, we have a special guest that's going to be joining us on Friday. On it's like day 5 or day 6 of the cruise, and he goes, "How many of you love country music?" And this lady, I'm watching her. She's like, "Robert, she's I told you that was him!" Like screams at her husband that's like right here, you know. And I felt sorry for him. I was like. I've been here all week. You know, it's not like I'm going anywhere. But it's very different. Either the cruises are one thing because it's strictly relaxation, and you can fill your day with as much stuff as you want to do, or you can do nothing and still have a great time. You know, and the parks are the same way. I mean, you know, my kids will come down here, and my girls will. You know, my youngest too is me in a dress. It's got scary. She comes in one day and we've done, you know, multiple levels of different things throughout the years, and she comes in and we walk up to a ride and she goes, "I'm not standing in that line. It says 40 minutes. And I'm like, "Listen, kid, this is how real people do it. They get in that line." You know, we didn't make any fast passes. It was kind of one of those deals where it was just a last minute type thing. And so, yeah, you know, you can do as much stuff as you want to. You could literally fill a week down here at the parks and not do the same thing and have a full week. And you could do the exact same thing on the cruise. You know, we went to Disneyland a couple years ago. I was out there doing the Tournament of Roses parade. So it's, I guess it's in
Rose Bowl.
The Rose Bowl, yes, that's what I was looking for. We're doing the Rose Bowl Parade, and I took my daughter to Disneyland to walk where Walt walked and do all that. It was just, that was amazing, you know. But we have a love for this area because it's the one that we've built all our memories around.
So,
and
you're
Psalm
19-something. Mm-hmm. You open up with, you saw Star Wars at least 8 times.
Mm-hmm. Is that true?
Is that true?
Yes, it is.
Are you still a Star Wars fan?
I am a Star Wars fan. I didn't write 19-something. But if you listen to the music that I've recorded, if you listen to the songs that I've released, like, I feel like every one of them has to be autobiographical. Whether you write it or not, I think you have to be telling your story. And that's what I've always done. So 19-something was very true. The line of the song that embraced me and I knew I had to record it was the line about the stuff that's inside Stretch Armstrong. Yeah. And I'll tell you, my mom's not here, so I can tell you this story. She actually is here, but she's not in this room. I got one of the worst whippings of my life over an autopsy on Stretch Armstrong. Because we had moved into this house and it had this beautiful green shag carpet about that long. It was back before the days, you know, I was a kid. It was back before the days of going to Kroger and renting your own carpet cleaner. And so we, you know, my Stretch kind of developed a hole, and then, you know, a kitchen butcher knife later, and we're looking at it, and it gets on the carpet. And so it was like, "Oh, it's a spot." I'm like, "Okay, nobody tell mom here." And we start scrubbing it. And the spot goes to a spot like this big, and literally to the day we moved out of that house, I had two area rugs in my room covering the spot. And like every time my mom could see that spot, she would relive that moment and get really mad over that. So that was the line of the song. Star Wars at least 8 times, the Pac-Man pattern, that was all true. But the Stretch Armstrong line was very much the line that sold me. Yes, back to the Star Wars thing. I've always been a big fan of movies. I mean, that's my road manager Michael over here. That's 85% of our dialogue is quoting movies to each other on the road. That's just what we do, you know. And so it's something that all of the Disney movies have special meaning. Of course, my daughter being, you know, loving the princesses, you know, Frozen and Cinderella, you know, the classics. But then we also love, you know, like the Goofy movie is truly my favorite movie. You know, that's why I walked on stage last night and one of the stage techs on the side of the stage comes walking up and I'm getting ready to walk on stage and I've got my earbuds in and the intro's playing and he walks up to me and he goes, "Hey," and I go, and I pull my ears out and he goes, "Awesome shirt." And that was just what I needed because I was so nervous. You do this for a living and you don't get nervous about a lot of things. You know, I played the Washington, you know, Monument on the 4th of July. We had almost 1 million people and I wasn't nervous. I walked on, you know, the stage last night in the American Garden Theater in front of, you know, 2,000 people in the first show and I was scared to death because you spend your career has milestones and, you know, and you're playing something that I can't tell you how many shows I've watched there, you know, whether it be Sugar Ray or whether it be whoever, you know, 38 Special. You go down the list of the shows that I've sat in there and watched and nobody had, you know, people see you, but nobody pays attention to who you're sitting next to at Disney World, you know? I mean, I walked past Matt Damon one time in here and I went, that guy looks like Matt Damon. And just kept right on walking and I realized as I walked away, I saw the plaid vest and I was like, that was Matt Damon, you know? So you don't pay attention to that kind of stuff when you're down here. Everybody's lost in their own world. It's like they've got their blinders on. We've got a fast pass for test track in 15 minutes and we got to go, you know? So that's the way it works. But last night when I walked on stage for the first time, that was one of those career moments for me because I had achieved a goal that I had set, you know, several years ago when we started our work relationship with Disney. And it was really cool.
That adds into my next question. This is your first year here, at E2B. When you signed the contract or whatever to do this, did you realize that today was the anniversary for Epcot and that you would be playing that?
None of us did. And to my knowledge, when we signed the contract, I didn't know that today was the 35th anniversary until about a month ago. And the gentleman who books us, do y'all know Brad? He's like he's the talent buyer or the person that's kind of the manager. I may be wrong, but he's that kind of the manager over the buying portion of who he brings in for the stage. You know, that's his job, to provide the entertainment, to buy the entertainment for Eat to the Beat and Candlelight and stuff like that. So when we booked this, nobody said a word to me about you're going to be playing the 35th anniversary of Epcot. And about a month ago, I get this email saying, "Hey, and by the way, just so you know, you're playing the 35th birthday of Epcot." And I was like, "Well, there's no pressure there." Because, I mean, you know, people who are fans of the brand, if you're going to spend one day in the park this year, you're going to come to the birthday celebration. You know, so and for me, that's just a big honor. It's just kind of another little, you know, one of those little things that I look at as just being an honor. I don't know that he told me last night that he did not book me specifically for that day, but we were sitting in the dressing room after the show last night. And he said, "I got to be honest with you." He said, of everybody that I've ever booked for Beat to the Beat or for Candlelight, he said, you're the guy that should be playing this because of your love for Disney. And I said, well, thank you. I said, and then he follows that up with, and I didn't even do it on purpose. I'm like, well, thanks, Brad. Yeah, I mean, it was just kind of a, I guess, a neat coincidence.
Where would you like to go with Disney from here? If we need a new country music movie.
I don't know. So in the beginning of my career, I did a voiceover for Tom Sawyer. I was Huckleberry Finn. It was an MGM production at the time. And they contacted me and said, hey, we've got a song. Would you like to sing on it? And I said, well, send me the song. And I said, what is it? And they said, well, and I was on tour. I had done some shows with Lee Ann Womack. And Lee Ann Womack had been asked about singing basically the end credit for this movie. And they said, well, we would like for you to come listen to the song. I went in and listened to the song. They said, while you're here, would you like to read for a bit part? And I said, well, sure. And so I went in and they handed me a script and they're like, okay, so you're going to read this. And I'm like, okay. And so the casting director goes, blah, blah, blah. And I go, blah, blah, blah. And he goes, that's great. Now, take it up an octave because you're a kid. And I was like, blah, blah, blah. And he goes, great, you're hired. And in the movie Tom Sawyer, I became Huckleberry Finn. So I became the number two part in the movie because I was singing on the soundtrack. And it was to benefit St. Jude, which was something that I'm big into. I totally forgot to tell y'all, I've been a Children's Miracle Network ambassador for about the last 10 years. So that was another reason why our love of Disney just continued on, because Disney was supporting, you know, as sort of a host facility, something that was really important to me, and that was dealing with, you know, the children's hospitals around the country. And that was another big reason why we got involved. But, I wouldn't mind at some point doing some voiceover work. I love music. That's all I ever really wanted to do. And so I'm content at this level with playing Food and Wine and doing other things like that. But yeah, I mean, I'm sure as my career slows down or as I, you know, reach different plateaus or milestones, you know, we may work in a different direction with some other stuff like that.
So storytelling, songs, what Disney song or attraction or what story do you like there? Disney attraction song.
Well, I mean, you can't talk about Disney attractions and not talk about the Sherman Brothers.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, if I've watched The Boys one time, I've watched it 1,000 times.
Yes.
Because there is no, the songs are what tell the stories.
Yes.
And that's the way musicians work. You know, so for me, I mean, you got Menken and you got guys like that, Al Menken that did The Little Mermaid.
Yep.
And different stories like that. But I still revert back to the Sherman Brothers because they told, you know, the Tiki Room. They told, you know, supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. They had a plethora of these ideas that came in. But personally for me would be the Goofy movie, just because of, you know, the whole movie revolved around getting to California to be on stage with Powerline.
Yeah.
Because he was trying to impress a girl. And I'm a musician, you know, so I mean, you know, you got to be on stage to impress the girls, you know, but yeah, I mean, that's probably the Goofy movie, more than anything, because it tells, I kind of feel that's sort of a personal story for me, even though there's nothing about it that's personal, but you know,
it's
I'm
good.
A Goofy fan, and I think that's one of my favorite
too.
Stories.
We'll wrap up questions unless you have one more. But other than that, if you'd like to get some photographs, and then we'll let him get rested up and ready for his.
There's no rest for me today.
His big anniversary performance. So,
that's right.
I do not do the perfect cast. However, I do have a picture of Goofy and I doing the perfect cast. I took it just the other day. It's one of my, check this out. I'm telling you, it's awesome. We were, actually, I take that back. It's not me. It is my daughters and Goofy doing the perfect cast.
Oh, nice. That's
perfect. Because he was like, can you do the perfect cast? And I said, not in these tight jeans. Because we were standing over there, and you know, and of course, we come in for the photo shoot, and Charles comes and picks us up, and he's like, we're going to do this photo shoot. And I was like, can we do it quickly? Because these pants are too tight. You know? Notice I showed up in all my walking around the park gear.
That's a food and wine thing, too, by the way.
Yeah, I got my loose shorts on, got the flip-flops, got the tan that goes along with the flip-flops. So, yeah, that's how we rock it down here.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Love the Sherman Brothers call out. Thank you. And next video is the entire first set from Epcot 35 Mark Wills Eat to the Beat concert series. SamsDisneyDiary.com, the Disney Nerds podcast. We'll see you next time. Congaloosh.